pray with me. Shine your light on your word, O God, and by your Spirit, let us see your wonder. Your justice extends beyond our sense of fairness, and your love overwhelms us. Open our eyes and our ears. Show us the way to live and love. Amen. There were two churches. The first church was a small rural church just outside a large city. Each Sunday, about 25 adults gathered for worship. Years before that, there used to be more, especially more children and youth. Each month, the church struggled to meet its expenses. The church could no longer afford a full-time pastor, so they joined with two other small churches, and together they financially supported one pastor. The parsonage and the sanctuary needed a lot of work. Whenever it rained, the basement of the sanctuary would flood, but they didn't have the money to do the necessary repairs. The church did have an endowment, though, in the amount of $100,000 that couldn't be touched because it was reserved for scholarships, even though they no longer had any children or youth. Several years passed, and the church remains the same. There was another small church that over the years also had a significant decline in membership until there were between 12 and 15 adults worshiping each week. This one was an urban church sitting in the middle of a unique downtown neighborhood that had changed several times throughout the years. They too had an endowment. It was to be used on mission and ministry in their community. That church closed in 2015, and when it did, they turned over their facility and all of their assets, including their endowments, to a new church start that continues to grow and is actively involved in ministries with their neighborhood. Someone once said, if a church uses every cent of God's money on God's ministries and they are left with a zero balance, it cannot be considered a failure. It's faithfulness and obedience. Which of those two churches would you describe as the most faithful? In today's parable, Jesus is approaching the end of his ministry on earth, and his teachings take on this sense of urgency as he talks to the disciples about the kingdom of God. In the previous chapter, he had told the disciples that the faithful and wise servants would be put in charge of everything that belongs to God, and it comes with great responsibility. Last week, I explained that parables are intended to catch us off guard, and they're meant for us to ask, what in the world is Jesus talking about? At the time, it was unthinkable that a property owner would turn over his possessions to his servants. And Jesus is telling the disciples that God entrusts us with astounding wealth, power, and responsibility. Each of us receiving a number of talents based on our ability and our potential. A talent was estimated to be 15 years' worth of wages. So to get an idea of God's extravagant generosity, multiply your annual income, or the annual income you earned when you were in the workforce, by 15. The first servant received 5 talents, or 75 years worth of wages. The second received 2 talents, or 30 years of wages. And the third received 1 talent, equal to 15 years of wages. The property owner didn't give any specific instructions on what they were to do with the money. I suspect it depended on the greatest need of the community. But God expected them to take initiative and be creative with the talents they were given. There's this expectation that they will be as generous as their master and use the talents in building up the kingdom of God. The first went to work using the five talents, and he received five more. Likewise, the second disciple doubled his talents. The third disciple, however, decided to play it safe and buried it in the ground. The Palestinian culture at that time would have said that the third servant was the one who did the right thing by burying the talents in the ground, because it was the most prudent and safest thing to do. If someone gave you money to hold in trust and you buried it in the ground and it was stolen, rabbinic law stated that you were not held liable because burying it was the safest, was the best safeguard against theft. The third disciple did what any trustworthy and responsible servant was expected to do with someone else's money. After some time had passed, the property owner returned and called his disciples to give an account of what happened. The first two were confident that they used their talents wisely and responsibly according to God's purposes. Afterwards, they were deemed good and faithful servants, invited to share in the joy of God's kingdom. God really didn't care how much money they made. That isn't what was important. What's important is their obedience, their commitment, their loyalty, and their faithfulness to God and building up God's kingdom. The disciples who heard Jesus tell this parable would have been greatly troubled to hear the master praise and reward those two servants for taking great risks with money that didn't belong to them. They went against cultural expectations by taking a chance at losing everything they were given. The biblical story portrays an angry God, though I suspect that Jesus was probably more disappointed than angry. That third disciple had been trusted with a priceless gift that he chose not to use. He had the opportunity to make a difference in the kingdom of God, but chose to play it safe. He was unwilling to take a chance with the possibility of losing what he had, so he didn't do anything at all. His actions indicated fear and a lack of trust in God. An aspect of the story that I find interesting is that when the master returns, those first two servants show their master what they've accomplished, but they don't give the talents back. Whereas the third servant eagerly wants to give that one talent back to God, implying that he has no intention of using the talent in the future. It's as if he's making a choice to permanently walk away from God's abundance. Many of us know that Jesus can be demanding, but he isn't unreasonable. He expects a gain on his investment in us. He expects us to use our gifts and talents to the best of our abilities. He wants us to be ambitious for the kingdom. As the body of Christ, we are expected to be aggressive investors, using all of God's resources, money, property, laity, clergy, in building up the kingdom of God. We are expected to take risks, to be generous and creative, and to try new things, even when it makes us uncomfortable. We use God's talents to share God's love in order to transform the world, beginning with our own neighborhoods. What the church does or doesn't do with the talents she is given directly impacts our community and the kingdom of God. So the decision is ours. Are we willing to risk it all? Or will we choose to play it safe? Let us pray. God of mercy, the gift of your Son is the life-changing treasure that is truly beyond value. Your generosity and goodness amaze us. Inspire us to teach your commandments and share your gospel, that all may enter into the joy of Christ.